Hello friends! Today I will share some other CSS tips that every front-end developer should know. Firstly, I want to talk about the universal selector, the HTML tag, and the body tag. These elements are familiar to most of web developers, and we all use them to define our default background color, text color, and font family, but understanding their roles and differences can be a bit confusing. So let's clarify their purposes using this HTML file. I'm gonna write a text here, and now I want to give a background color to my website. But which element should I use? Let's give a background color here. Okay, it works. Now I'm gonna comment this out and give a background color for the HTML tag. Again, this is what we want. And if I do the same thing for the body tag, you'll see it also works. You might think it doesn't matter where to use the global styles, but if you don't understand the difference, it might cause some problems in the future. In the example, you can say the body element covers all the viewport, but let's give the background color again for the HTML and see what happens. As you realize, the body height equals the maximum content size. I didn't change any size here, but the body tag is smaller now. Well, it's not actually getting smaller. It's always been small. Let's check the inspector and pick the body element, and you can see that the height is around 19 pixels. Now I will comment this out, and the background color is body's color, but the body size is still the same. And if you check the HTML element, its height is around 35 pixels. So HTML and body tags do not actually cover the whole viewport. What happens here is, when you give a background for one of these tags, even if their size are still the same, the background color is propagated to the viewport. It's the default behavior of CSS. And this is why we often see people use 100% sizing for HTML and body. But in most cases, you won't even need that. Let's remove them and give a background color for one of these tags. Recommended way to use a background color is to use it inside body tag. What about this universal selector? Some people think it's the parent of the HTML tag, but it's a selector that selects all the elements inside our document. This is important because some of HTML elements have default styles that cannot be inherited from the parent. What I mean by that? As you can see, the body element has a default margin here. And I cannot remove this by giving margin 0 here. Or if you have an H1 tag, again, it has a margin. Let's create a list and add some items inside. And it has a margin and also a padding. And I cannot remove them using the parent. It removes only its own margin here. So I have to use each element one by one and remove the margin and padding. And this is why we need this universal selector. It selects all the elements in our document and applies a style for them. So if I say margin and padding 0, it's gonna apply for every single element. Another popular property is box sizing. Let's create a box here, and I will give a size, background color, padding, and a border. And as you can see, the box size is more than 100 pixels. After adding the padding and border, the total size is 140 pixels. To prevent this globally, we can use box sizing border box. And now the total size is 100 pixels. Using margin, padding, and box sizing is a very common usage, but it depends on your project. If you design a blog page with many text elements inside, like titles, paragraphs, lists, removing all the margin and padding might not be the best idea. Also, do not use a background color or text color here, because when you use nested items, it will cause some problems. Let's create a section here and a container inside. And I will give a background color for the section. As you can see, the background is still this color because we selected our div element and changed its color. If I move the background color to the body, I can see the section background. Okay, right now you know the main purpose of these elements, so let's see the second CSS tip. I'm gonna show you how to create snap scroll effect and what we should pay attention to when using it. Let's create 5 sections and put some texts. Each section is gonna contain the whole viewport, so I will say height 100 VH. Let's increase the font size and give a color, and using and child selector, I will give different background color for each section. Right now, we are ready to give the snap effect. To do that, we need a scroll container. So if we create a container and give overflow scroll or auto, it becomes a scroll container. HTML tag is a scroll container by default. We can use it in the CSS file, or we can create a new div and give it an overflow. I will say overflow. Let's make this hidden first, and the height will be 100 VH. As you can see, it ends at this point and I cannot scroll. But if I change here, I will be able to scroll down and see my items. Basically, this scroll bar belongs to container, not to HTML. Let me change the size. As you can see, the bar is here. Okay, let's remove this and give a scroll snap type. We'll scroll vertically, so I will use the Y axis and I will add the type, and it's gonna be mandatory. I'm gonna explain this in a moment. And in this section, I need to provide the snap position. Scroll snap align. It can be start, center, or end. But in our case, it doesn't matter because our sections are full screen. As you can see, it works as expected. But if I change the size and align to the center, it's gonna show the item in the middle of the container. Let's take this back and change this type. When it's mandatory, as soon as I release my fingers, it snaps to the other section. But if I make this proximity, I can scroll down and it snaps only when it's close enough to the other section. And it gives a more flexible scrolling experience. Okay, after snap scrolling, let's talk about this font size. I'm gonna zoom out and make this 100%. Remember, we used here 72 pixels. But as most of you know, the recommended size unit is RAM, not pixels. If you don't know why it's recommended, let me explain quickly, and after I will give a small font size trick. I'm gonna open my browser settings and find the font size. By default, it's medium, but some people, including my mom, using their computers and phones with the large font size. But if I change here, nothing happens because we fixed our font size to 72 pixels. And it never changes. To prevent this, instead of pixels, we can use RAM. And 1 RAM equals 16 pixels. 72 divided by 16 equals 4.5 RAM. And now, the font size changes as we expected. But the problem is the calculation of RAM units. If you are not familiar, it can be hard to work with. If you are using 20 pixels, for example, it should be 1.25 RAM. If you are using 30, it should be 1.875 RAM. But don't worry, there is an easier way to use it. As you know, the default global font size is 16 pixels. And using HTML tag, I wanna convert it to the 10 pixels to make the calculation easier. To do that, I will say font size 62.5%. And right now, the default size is 10 pixels, and it equals 1 RAM. Using the body tag, I can set the default font size to 1.6 RAM, and it equals 16 pixels again. And now, it's much easier to use RAM unit. Instead of this size, I can use 2 RAM, which is 20 pixels, or 3 RAM, which is 30 pixels. Okay, let me give you another CSS tip. Let's say we have a list here, but instead of list element, we are using h2 tags. And inside we have some texts, and before each text, I want to write section and the number of that section. So it's going to be section 1, HTML tutorial, section 2, CSS tutorial, 3, 4, and 5. But how am I going to do this without using JavaScript? I can actually create a counter using CSS, and it's really easy. Firstly, I will define my counter inside body using counter reset, and I will write here the name of the counter. It can be anything. And the default value is 0 right now. But how am I gonna write a text before each item? To do that, I can use before selector and write anything inside the content. Let's say section. After, I can show my counter using counter function. As you can see, it's 0 because we didn't increment our number. In order to do that, I can use counter increment and pass my counter name here. And right now we can see the chapters, and we can add a new item without changing all the titles. And the last tip is order property. I will create a container, and inside I will add 4 boxes. The first one will be red box, blue box, green, and orange. Let's give a size and a text color. And for each box, I will give their backgrounds. And our container will be a flex box. Let's give a space between items. And now I can give a specific order for any item using order property. Let's say order 2, order 1, 4, and 3. As you can see, it's that easy to give different priorities to our Flexbox items. Okay guys, that's all. If you didn't watch the first part of this series, the link will be in the description below. And if you want to see the third part of the CSS tips, please like the video and let me know in the comments. I really enjoy creating CSS content, but it depends on the video likes and views. Okay. You can support Lama Dev by joining the channel or using the link in the description below. Don't forget to follow Lama Dev's social media accounts. I hope I'll see you in the next video. Goodbye.